really excited to be here at Microsoft Research Summit 2021. My name is Dong Song, a professor in computer science at UC Berkeley and also the founder of Oasis Labs. Today, I will talk about towards building a responsible data economy. As we all know, data is a key driver for modern economy and is the lifeblood of AI and machine learning. A huge amount of data is being collected every day, and it is estimated that a significant portion of EU's GDP comes from value from personalized data. And the global data economy is growing at an exponential speed. However, a lot of this data is sensitive, and both individuals and organizations are facing unprecedented challenges in how sensitive data is being used. First, individuals have lost control over how their data is being used. Oftentimes, users' data is misused or sold without their knowledge and consent. And a lot of this data is being sold under the premise that the data has been anonymized. However, volume of research has shown that anonymization doesn't adequately protect users' privacy. So what you see on the screen here is an example, a case study that New York Times has done, showing that from anonymized mobile phone location datasets that they were able to obtain, they were able to track the location of a Secret Service agent with former President Trump, and hence also revealing the information about the location and trajectory of former President Trump. And data breaches continue to plague businesses. Many large-scale attacks have stolen sensitive information about hundreds of millions of users or billions of users in each one of these attacks. And also, businesses now is becoming more and more expensive and cumbersome for businesses to comply with privacy regulations such as CCPA and GDPR. The bigger issue is that a lot of valuable data is being locked up in data silos and not being able to be utilized due to privacy concerns. So today, we are really seeing facing huge challenges in how to utilize sensitive data to the extent that these problems, if not addressed, they will significantly hinder societal progress and to the extent that it will undermine human values and fundamental rights. And thus, we have an urgent need for a framework for a responsible data economy. What do I mean by a responsible data economy? What are the goals and principles of a responsible data economy? So first, we need to establish and enforce data rights. Data rights form the foundation of data economy and prevent misuse and abuse of data. And we would also like to enable fair distribution of value created from data, such that users can gain sufficient benefit from their data. And ultimately, we would like to enable efficient data use to maximize social welfare and economic efficiency so that data can be utilized for individuals, organizations, governments, and society's best interest. There are many unique challenges and complexity due to the nature of data. So first, there's natural tension between utility and privacy. On one hand, we want to utilize data to extract value out of data. On the other hand, we need to be able to protect privacy of users' data. And also, data has a unique property called non-rivalry, which is different from physical objects. So with the physical objects, for example, if I hold an apple in my hand, then nobody else can be holding the same apple at the same time. So this is called rivalry. However, for data, data is different. Data has nature of non-rival, meaning that if I hold a copy of a piece of data, then somebody else can hold a copy of the same piece of data, and they can utilize the data just as well as I can in this case. And hence, due to this non-rivalry property, once data is given out, is copied, one can never really take the data back. And data also has properties such as data dependency and data externality. For example, process data can review information about the original data because the process data has been computed from the original data. And also data about one entity can review information about another entity. Because of these unique properties of data, we cannot simply copy concepts and methods in the analog world. Instead, we need to develop a new framework for a responsible data economy. And this requires a combination of technical and non-technical solutions. In particular, a framework for a responsible data economy needs to have at least three components: technical solutions, incentive models, and legal framework. So first, let me talk about the technical solutions. So traditional solutions are insufficient. In traditional solutions, data encryption has mainly been used to protect data at rest or in transit. And data is not really protected when being in use. And in fact, data is either not used, or when it's used, it's often copied, and thus making it difficult to control future usage of the data. And also, as I mentioned earlier, anonymizing data is often insufficient to protect users' data privacy. So we need to develop new technologies, in particular, to protect data while data is in use. And in order to achieve this, we need to address two main goals. One is that we need to be able to enable controlled use of data so that data can be used without having to copy the raw data. And second, we also need to be able to protect the computation outputs from leaking sensitive information about the original input. Luckily, in the research community, there has been huge advancements in developing new technologies to address these issues. And I call these technologies responsible data technologies. And given the complexity of the issue and the different aspects for addressing the issue, we need to have different component technologies together to enable responsible data use. In particular here, I list four examples of component technologies, including secure computing, such as using secure hardware, MPC, fully homomorphic encryption, and so on, to keep data confidential even when data is in use by application. And differential privacy helps protect the computation output from leaking sensitive information. And fair distributed learning utilizes secure computing and differential privacy and enable data to stay at the data owner's devices without leaving the data owner's devices and enable distributed data analytics and model training across different devices. And finally, with distributed ledger, it helps provide an immutable log of users' data rights and how data has been utilized to ensure that data usage is compliant. So first, let me talk briefly about the first component technology, secure computing. The goal of secure computing is to protect the computation process from leaking sensitive information. And there are different types of technologies for secure computing, including using secure hardware as well as cryptographic-based techniques, such as secure multi-party computation and fully homomorphic encryption. The challenge for cryptographic-based approaches is that the performance overheads often can be very high, can be orders of magnitude higher than native computation, and hence can only support special purpose computation. In the recent years, there has been a huge advancement in improving performance overhead for these cryptographic-based methods, such as homomorphic encryption and multi-party computation. However, today, there's still a huge gap in terms of the performance enabled by these cryptographic-based approaches versus what is really needed in practice for computation with the practical large-scale workload. For example, today, using homomorphic encryption and MPC methods for training, for example, machine learning models on certain real-world data sets, it can still take orders of magnitude slower than native computation and, for example, training ImageNet with a VGG16 takes many years to do using these type of approaches. So another type of approach is to use secure hardware. The advantage of using secure hardware is that the performance overhead is much lower, oftentimes close to native performance, and hence can be used to support general purpose computation. And for secure hardware, usually it utilizes a combination of hardware and software mechanisms to provide an isolated execution environment, often called a secure enclave. When applications are running inside the secure enclave, nothing outside, for example, including the operating system and other applications, will be able to modify the data inside the secure enclave and its execution, or seeing information, learning information about the data and execution running inside the secure enclave, and hence provide integrity and confidentiality for computation in the secure enclave. And also, secure enclave provides a capability called remote attestation to enable a remote verifier to verify the initial state of the secure enclave and the program that's running inside the secure enclave, and hence provides a remote verification of the computation inside the secure enclave. Given its strong security capabilities, secure enclaves can serve as a cornerstone security primitive that enable a platform for building new security applications that couldn't be built otherwise for the same practical performance. Given its importance, different hardware manufacturers have been developing different solutions for secure hardware. However, all these are closed source. In order to truly enable trustworthy secure enclave, I strongly believe that we need an open source solution for secure hardware. This will help us to provide the security assurance that's needed for a truly trustworthy secure enclave. And towards this goal, at Berkeley, we have been developing a project called the Keystone, which provides the first open framework for building customizable secure hardware, also called Trusted Execution Environments, TEES. Keystone is built on top of RISC-V, which is open source RISC architecture, and it utilizes capabilities, memory isolation capabilities provided by RISC-V, and enables a modular and flexible design to enable a minimum trusted computing base that can better facilitate formal verification. With the Keystone, from our experiments, we show that the performance overhead can be close to native performance. For example, for different machine learning benchmarks and other benchmarks. And today you can try out Keystone on the latest RISC-V board, as well as using FPGAs and also emulation. And Keystone is now supported by the Confidential Computing Consortium with global members of different leading technology companies and other entities. I strongly believe that in 10 years, secure computing will become a commonplace. In 10 years, most chips will have secure enclave, secure execution environment capabilities. And in 10 years, most computation will utilize secure enclaves. And also in 10 years, hardware accelerators for cryptographic methods for secure computation will also be widely available. So that's the first component technology for secure computing. Now let me briefly talk about the second component technology, differential privacy. To motivate why we need differential privacy, first let me illustrate with some recent case studies that we have done. So in our recent work in collaboration with researchers from Google and other places, we set out to explore the question, do neural networks remember training data? If yes, can attacker utilize or exploit this issue to be able to extract secrets in the original training data from just simply querying the learned models? So in this case study, we focus on language models. So with language models, it's trained over a corpus of texts. And when given a sequence of words or characters, the language model will predict the next word or the next character. So for example, language models has had wide applications and adoption, for example, in Smart Compose and so on. So the question is, in this case, can attackers, by just simply querying the learned model, actually learn sensitive information in the original training data? So this is an interesting example that in this case, the attacker was able to, by utilizing the learned model, to really identify and learn sensitive information about the revolution. So in our case study, here is an example where we show that the case study here is to train a language model, an email dataset called the Enron email dataset. The Enron email dataset actually contained actual users, credit card, and social security numbers. Our work showed that an attacker, without knowing any details of the model, including the model architecture and the parameters of the model, by just simply querying the learned model, the attacker is able to automatically extract users' credit card and social security numbers that were embedded in the original training data. So this is an example illustrating that as we train machine learning models, it's important to take precaution to protect users, to protect the privacy of users' data. In our work, we also proposed a measure called exposure to measure the degree of memorization, and it has been utilized in, for example, Google Smart Compose to help improve privacy protection. And in our more recent work, we also extended the work to study larger scale language models, such as GPT-2. And we have developed new attacks illustrating that even for these large scale language models, similar issues also appears. And attackers in this case, by just querying the GPT-2 model, for example, is able to extract personally identifiable information that has been used in the training data set. So what can we do in this case? How can we train better machine learning models that provides better protection for users' data privacy? In this case, in our work, we show that in certain cases, we can utilize solutions such as differential privacy to help address the issue. So for example, the earlier work we showed that by training a differentially private language model instead of a vanilla language model, in certain cases, we can still maintain a similar utility for the model. And at the same time, we can significantly enhance the privacy protection for users' data from these trained models. So differential privacy is a formal notion of privacy that helps protect users' data from the data analytics and machine learning models computed from these from users' original data. But however, deploying differential privacy in practice has many challenges. In our work, we have developed automated techniques to enable automatic rewriting of data analytics programs to automatically embed differential privacy mechanisms into data analytics queries, such that one doesn't need to change the backend of the original database, and also the data analyst doesn't need to know anything about differential privacy. This rewritten data analytics query will then automatically produce differentially private results, and hence make it easy to deploy differential privacy, and also at the same time to be able to provide automatic protection for users' data privacy. And also in our recent work, we also developed a new higher order language and type system to be able to statically analyze programs and in this language and to enforce differential privacy. We are able to automatically compute the privacy bounds and hence be able to automatically prove differential privacy, for example, machine learning algorithms and so on. And our work has won the Distinguished Paper Awards at top program language conference, Uppsala. And some of our work has been deployed and piloted at different industries. So given the interest of time, I won't be able to go into the details for all these different component technologies. And when we combine these different component technologies, including secure computing, differential privacy, federated learning, and distributed ledger, we can build a secure distributed computing fabric that can serve as the platform for a responsible data economy. So here is a quick workflow, how when these component technologies are put together can enable this platform for a responsible data economy. So in this case, the data provider can provide bundles of data together with its desired policy of how data is being utilized. For example, data may be only used for training differentially private machine learning models and so on. And the data will be encrypted in this case together, bundled with the data use policy. And this information can then be committed to a blockchain, which provides the immutable ledger for this data rights and data use policy. And now when a data analyst and data consumer wants to use the data, the data analyst can submit the analytics and machine learning program that will that the data analyst wants to run on the data. And now an access controller will take the latest data use policy from the blockchain for the data and also the analyst program. And the access controller also has a static analyzer component, which will check the policy against the program and also outputs what we call a residual policy that governs the use of the computation result. And if the static analyzer checks that the program is compliant with the use policy of the data, it will then send a proof of the policy compliance to a distributed key manager. Then the access controller will then also instantiate a trusted execution environment, and the data, the encrypted data will be loaded in the trusted execution environment, and the distributed key manager can then send the decryption key to the trusted execution environment. Then the data can be decrypted and the computation can be done. And then the computed result will then be encrypted with the residual policy. And this information will then also be committed to the blockchain and also provide an immutable log for how the data has been utilized. And this encrypted results, depending on the residual policy, can then be further utilized. For example, the analyst can download the results, can query train the models, or run additional programs that satisfies the residual policy. And also, the data provider in this case can inspect the blockchain to see how their data has been utilized. So overall, this distributed secure computing platform can then be utilized to support what I call data commons for decentralized data science. So in this setting, the data owners, data producers, they will register their data sets with the policy specified to a distributed data catalog. And the data consumer and data analyst can then search this distributed catalog. And as it finds relevant data, it can write data analytics and machine learning programs over these different data sets and data sources, and submit the program to this distributed platform that I described earlier. And this distributed platform, a security platform, can then provide distributed secure computing while ensuring that the program is compliant with the desired policies. So enables privacy-preserving utilization of data from distributed data sources. This approach, it can help reduce friction of data use, remove data silos, and enforce strong security and privacy protection. I strongly believe that in 10 years, data trust and data commons will become predominant ways of utilizing diverse sources of data and enabling ownership economy where users benefit from their data as owners and partners. In 10 years, data stewards, fiduciaries, and trustees will be a new class of entities important in the data ecosystem, managing and protecting users' data and growing its value. And in 10 years, a huge economic value will be created through these new forms of data trust and data commons, orders of magnitude higher than today's data marketplace. And when we combine privacy computing and blockchain, it can also enable a new type of assets that I call data assets. In this case, blockchain helps enable providing an immutable lock of users' rights to data and data use policies, and also help enforce the use policies is being satisfied. And with the privacy computing, it can ensure that data remains private during compute and cannot be reused without permission. And this capsule of data and policies can create a new type of asset that I call data assets that helps users to both protect their data privacy and also at the same time to gain value from their data. And with this approach, with data assetization, we can unlock a new responsible data economy where users and businesses can maintain data rights and earn value from their data assets. And in our recent work at Oasis Labs, we have been putting this approach into practice. And in particular, we have developed technologies to help users to maintain control of their genomic data and also at the same time to enable their data to be utilized in a privacy-preserving way and enable data users to be able to gain value from their data as well. So far, I have focused on the first components of a responsible data economy, the technical solutions. So now I will briefly talk about this, the two other components, incentive models and legal frameworks. So we need to have better incentive models, for example, how to determine and distribute value of data. Existing data valuation approaches are ad hoc and insufficient. In our recent work, we have showed that we can model machine learning as a collisional game and utilize the concept of Shapley value to define and to build a rigorous framework to show that how we can distribute value created from machine learning models to the data contributors. Given the interest of time, I won't go through the details of Shapley value. At a high level, Shapley value computes for each player, essentially its expected marginal contribution of the player's data to the trained machine learning models, to the utility function. And we have developed efficient algorithms to compute Shapley value for training machine learning models with large-scale data. And we also need to establish legal frameworks to help address some of the open challenges regarding to data rights. For example, what are data rights and who controls data rights? Individual property rights are a cornerstone of modern economy and has helped establish modern economics and fueled centuries of significant growth. And today we lack an adequate framework for data rights. Establishing data rights will allow individuals to derive value from their data and propel economic growth and unlock new value. And there has been diverse concepts and frameworks proposed in this space. And overall, we need data-driven, technology-informed regulation. For example, how will advancement of responsible data technology influence and impact regulatory frameworks? And how can regulation help with faster and broader adoption of responsible data technology? For the future of the internet, we must build a responsible data economy. And the 2020s is a decade for building a responsible data economy. Thank you.